50 years on, what wonderful things we have done, what wonderful things there remain for us to do. It is truly a time for celebration for the BC Civil Liberties Association and for those who believe in the principles that it was established to promote. 50 years ago, a group of individuals committed to the protection and advancement of civil liberties and human freedom came together to form the BCCLA. They recited that we should look to the UN Declaration of Human Rights, the Canadian and US Bill of Rights, the French Declaration of the Rights of Man, and similar documents as guides. Their interest in civil liberties was no doubt stoked by the recent memory of having fought a great war against a totalitarian and racist regime. It no doubt drew inspiration from words such as those found in the inaugural address of President John F. Kennedy. It no doubt was stirred as well in Canada by having our own Canadian Bill of Rights put into law. There were causes to join and political battles to fight. The great melody of liberty was like a tune that they simply couldn't get out of their heads. Concern for ending segregation in the U.S. was in the news, but locally, concern for the treatment of Dukhobors, Jehovah's Witnesses, First Nations people, the memories of how we had treated Japanese and Canadians during World War II with internment camps, all no doubt raised awareness and a sense that there was shame in inaction. The plight of Aboriginal communities across Canada and how they were excluded from voting up until the late 50s and 60s in Canada, and excluded from other entitlements of full citizenship, was obviously something to work to reform. A host of wrongs needed to be righted, and there existed a sense of both adventure and challenge, mixed with a conviction of there being clear answers as to what was right and what was wrong. The association started off small, but quickly attracted many of the most thoughtful minds and leading voices of freedom in British Columbia. Michael Adain, who will be somebody who we hear from tomorrow night, his story is noteworthy. The association started in his living room while he was a student. Tom Berger and Bill Deverell were young lawyers with reform in mind and played their part. I could mention many, many more people, and their names will be heard over the next couple of days as we reflect on the past and look forward to the future. As the 60s rolled into the 70s, other people came forward, like Reg Robson, a sociology professor at UBC, who devoted an enormous amount of time to this association and to advancing the cause of freedom and liberty in Canada. One example I like to talk about, because it shows how one can be a still small voice talking to a hurricane and still many years after be looked upon as someone who not only had a point but probably had the better side of the argument. In 1970, during the October crisis, when most of the country fell in behind the mantra of just watch me in terms of how far government could go to suppress legitimate dissent and political activity, Reg Robson and the BCCLA stood up and spoke out. When the Public Order Act was proposed and debated as a replacement for the War Measures Act, the association argued against lowering the bar for when intrusive state action that would erode rights and freedoms should be able to do so. We joined with other civil liberties and human rights groups across the country pressing for constitutional recognition of fundamental freedoms through the 70s and into the 1980s. When the Charter came into force in 1982, we celebrated that, but we realized once again that the work was not done. We knew that the work of bringing about a society that was truly just and truly respected the rights and human dignity of everyone had just been given a stronger tool, another means of getting recognition and getting attention. We have brought lawsuits and intervened in many cases since then. I was involved in one in the 1980s as a young lawyer that challenged electoral districting in the province and made meaningful the right to vote and have votes be counted on an equal and effective basis. Our efforts to protect free expression, freedom of choice, and freedom of conscience when government action intruded on personal matters is well known. Our work to ensure respect for gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgendered, and other people and groups is ongoing. Our commitment to those suffering in the AIDS crisis in the 1980s and beyond, and our work on catastrophic rights through such members as John Dixon and Stan Persky deserve special mention. In the 1990s, cases like the Little Sisters litigation, where we stood up for the voices of one small group against the forces of Canada Customs that was engaging in what the courts determined to be arbitrary and unreasonable behavior in precluding the importation of some materials. That litigation took the better part of a decade to fight, and it still has to go on. We have grown as an association, of course. Originally, it was a group of volunteers and a social group in many respects, but it eventually acquired a base, a paid staff, an ongoing board of directors that met monthly and governed how things would be dealt with. Among our staff, we've been blessed with many, many wonderfully committed people. Currently, Dave Eby, Michael Vaughan, Grace Pastine, Carmen Chung, Jim Breinigal, and numerous others, including some who come for short times, like Kate Milbury, who's helped put together this event, are all people who, for me, are a constant source of inspiration and pride. When I note, for example, that we go beyond paid staff to volunteers, interns, and others, including, you may recall, during the Olympics, training 400 observers to go out and be on the streets to watch to make sure that the police, and in a sense as well, the demonstrators, all engaged in lawful and peaceful demonstration and exercise their right of free expression, I think that we achieved a quite marvelous thing. We have as well the legal community and many, many lawyers who have on a pro bono basis donated their time and talents through the years. It is quite remarkable what we've done in court cases and the like. But there's more than that. We have had members who visit people in prison, who meet and visit people suffering from the clouds of mental illness, people who are marginalized and live in poverty, people who don't have a voice and really should have one. We've reached out to First Nations communities who've long suffered from systemic abuse by law enforcement and other state agents. You will hear today from a group of distinguished speakers about many of the different problems that we have worked to have recognized and understood, what the status of the issues is today and what remains to be done for the foreseeable future. The mandate of the association has been, at least in part, to educate, and today hopefully will contribute to that. It's also been to promote and to advocate, and you will hear the work that we've done in that regard. I often ask myself why we've had such success. It surely has not come from any one person's work. The association has had many heroes through the years who've helped at key points, but there have always been enough people to come forward, to move it forward, expand its reach, roll out its message, and to effect real change. On that score, this being a public symposium to which everyone is invited, of course, I'll issue a welcome and an invitation to anyone who may not have joined, may not have helped out in the past, but who finds that there is inspiration in what you hear today and something that you want to contribute. Feel free to come along. Feel free to contact the office. Feel free to contribute in any way that you can, because it's only by having an educated and a committed and a dedicated polity in a democratic society that will achieve the full meaning of civil liberties and human freedom. Now, I'm going over time, but I said even if I did, I had to do my signature, which is to include at least a snippet of poetry. A true understanding in my mind at least, of civil liberties involves not only a desire for others to recognize our own individuality and rights, but a sufficient degree of empathy to know that reciprocal respect and recognition for the rights of others is essential. Each of us is, at times, quite vulnerable and alone. But in democratic society, we offer ourselves up, our expressions, our thoughts, our desire to act or dress or believe in things in a certain way. We trust that others will accord us both the room to live our lives free from unreasonable constraints and the recognition that we are who we are. The poet W.B. Yeats captured the sense of this in these few words: "But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams." The price of reasonably being able to ask for recognition is that we must reciprocate. We have all no doubt experienced the sense of isolation, humiliation, and anger that goes with not being recognized. Being social has its risks as well as its rewards. So in sharing ourselves with others, we ask that they tread softly, because they do tread on our dreams. For civil libertarians, the message from this is hardly new. We respect the rights of others. In part, we do so because we expect that they will be accorded the same recognition and respect on our part. We are an organization that has a wonderful history. After 50 years, I think we can truly say what wonderful things we have done, what wonderful things remain for us to do. And now I'd like to call, if I can, on Michael Vaughan, our policy director, who will, following on her special interest in privacy matters, no doubt provide an eloquent introduction of our first speaker, Michael Geist. Thank you, Michael.
Okay, quick correction. I'm actually here to introduce the introducer. And this is an objective correlative, or really a metaphor, for what has been a joined-up effort in one of the most important files in the arena in the last couple of years. Now, the BCCLA has been at the forefront of a number of digital rights issues, up with net neutrality, down with ACTA, that sort of thing. But perhaps nothing that we have done has seen the kind of incredible snowball effect that our years and years of work that we've done opposing the expansion of police and intelligence surveillance powers over telecommunications, also known as lawful access. Now, our work in this area is best reflected in this magnificent report that I'm caromeriling right now for you. It is called Moving Towards a Surveillance Society: Proposals to Expand Lawful Access in Canada. It's freely available on our website. And this report has informed the work of advocates across Canada in this field. And up until a very short time ago, the number of those people would be maybe a couple of dozen. But not anymore. Our work alongside that of our traditional friends and allies, and I include in that category CIPIC from the University of Ottawa, locally here the BC Freedom of Information and Privacy Association, and many others. Our work has been taken up, amplified, set to a groovy soundtrack, and the show has been taken on the road thanks to grassroots advocates and activists like those at Open Media. So it is particularly fitting that we have Steve Anderson from Open Media, who's here to tell us a little bit about the incredible online campaign that they've developed and to introduce one of Canada's foremost authorities on all things internet. So please help me welcome Steve Anderson.
Thanks so much. I get the nice little spot of introducer of, in between introduced and introducer of Michael Geist. I'm not sure what that means exactly. But I'm really happy to be here. Thanks so much for inviting me. I'm Steve Anderson, the founder and executive director of a group operating in a gas town called openmedia.ca, and we bring Canadians together to safeguard the open and affordable internet. And we've had the great pleasure of partnering with the BCCLA on lawful access in particular, and I got to say that that research report and the forums you put on locally have been really helpful to the overall campaign, for sure. Now, as a way to, I was asked to kind of provide some local context to what I think Michael will talk about, which is the kind of overall movement to fight back, to stand up for our rights, our digital rights in particular. And so I think I'm going to do that in the form of a personal story. About my little part and how I came to this work in what I call the pro-internet movement. And I think Michael kind of features pretty prominently in a lot of this. So when I was, like a lot of people, when I was kind of finishing my undergrad in my early 20s, I was at this moment in my life where I was like, I basically didn't know what I wanted to do or what direction I wanted to go in. And I came to the conclusion that I don't know a lot, but I do know that there seems to be a really big opportunity with the internet for people to express themselves in new ways, to get engaged in politics in new ways, to stand up for their rights and liberties in new ways. So I decided I'll just give it a try. I'll try and start up a little news website, and I'll try and start producing videos as a citizen and kind of see where that takes me. And it didn't take me very far for a while. There's a lot of kind of odd jobs. I moved back home with my parents. I think for a while I was landscaping, and I also I remember one job I had. I was writing a setup guide for point of sale software for retailers, and I remember it was called Appaloosa and had this horse on the front of it. And I remember thinking to myself, I don't know how I'm going to spend a whole summer writing a point-of-sale software setup guide. Like, I don't know how that's going to work. And so I went to my boss and I said, would you let me write this as if I'm the horse? And he kind of looked at me and he's like, yeah, okay, sure. So long story short, I spent most of that summer writing things like, gallop up to the shift key and push enter. All that aside, and I think another kind of interesting part of that time is I decided that I needed some sort of organization, like a legal organization, if I was going to try and have this kind of website and media production stuff. And my illustrious board included people like my mom, my brother, and my sister-in-law, which I should say, only fairly recently I got to step down. But in the longer term, eventually things started working out. Independent media organizations started taking interest in my work, and things were kind of going well after a while. And then I heard from a group called Free Press that's based in the U.S., quite similar to Open Media now, that big telecom companies wanted to slow down and speed up websites, basically making the internet more like television. And so everything that I had kind of, all those opportunities for people to stand up for themselves in my own craft were basically under threat. And so I had a choice. I could basically just see where the wind blows, if things didn't work out well, maybe try and get a job for CTV, something like that. Or I could try and help Free Press and people in the U.S. who are standing up for the internet. And so I did that. I produced a mashup video about this issue called net neutrality. And basically, it's not very good, but it kind of hit at the right time when YouTube was getting big and organizations like civil liberty organizations in the U.S., in particular in Free Press, kind of ran with it. And it went viral. It's got about 560,000 views now. So basically, in the end, I think I played some part in that movement being successful. And when that kind of, when that happened, I kind of realized that I don't know what the Canadian context of this is. So I decided that I would go to grad school and learn about it and see what I could do in Canada. So I went to SFU and, read a lot of Michael Geist. And basically, myself and my supervisor and others decided that we needed to start an organization that worked on these issues. And so, if you kind of flash forward to the last year, and Michael will go into this in more detail, but if you look at the SOPA blackout that saw millions of people getting involved in these issues, standing up for their digital rights here in Canada, I've been lucky to be involved in a campaign called Stop the Meter that saw 500,000 Canadians sign a petition, biggest online campaign in Canadian history. And then there's the StopSpying.ca campaign, which is a coalition that we're involved in with the BCCLA that's got 135,000 signatures. And as some of you probably saw, a huge hashtag, Telvic Everything backlash that for now has got the government kind of pushing the pause button. And I'd like to say people working in other issues are regularly come up to me and are like, how did you do that? How did you stop the conservatives? And it's just about people power. And so just in sum, I got started in this because I believe that the internet holds huge opportunities for us to live out our right to free expression and to stand up for our rights. And I think, as many of you will know, that first time that you, that first take a taste of standing up for your rights, that first time that you kind of get involved in something real, it's addictive, and it's something that a lot of people, once you kind of step out and do that, you kind of can't move away from it. You're kind of a lifetime activist, or at least someone who remains involved, and it's very hard to pull back from that. And I think we're in a really interesting moment right now because there's hundreds of thousands of people in Canada and millions around the world who have just kind of dipped their toe in the water of political involvement. And I think that how we engage with those people really, in a lot of ways, will set the course for the future. And I think that's the kind of context that we're living in. And I think right now there's no better person than Professor Michael Geist, who's been involved in really all of this at a kind of national and international level. And there's no better time than now to talk about it. So with that, I'm pleased to introduce Michael Geist.
Great. Well, thanks, Steve, and thanks, Michael. It's a great honor to have the opportunity to come and participate in this event, and it's a thrill to be introduced by two of the real leaders on so many of these issues. But I have to say, it's particularly great to have the chance to participate in a 50th anniversary of BCCLA. I think nationally we have a number of civil liberties groups, not as many as we need. But the good news story is that there are a few, but only a few, that truly punch above their weight, that have an impact that extend far beyond local or regional issues. And the BCCLA is, I think, in the very top tier of groups that have that kind of impact. Frankly, sitting in Ottawa, we don't think of it as a BC group. We think of it as a national group that has an enormous impact. And so, from my perspective, it's great to have the chance to participate in this event. Now, as you might expect, given my area of interest, I'm going to talk about an issue that wasn't on the top of mind, I don't think, during those early days around a kitchen table. But I suspect over the next 50 years will increasingly occupy more and more of BCCLA's time, as well as many people concerned with civil liberties issues time, as we talk about various digital rights issues. So as you can see, I've titled this talk, the year the internet fought back, and I want to start with a story that is likely familiar to many of you. It starts just last October. We could probably go back further. There's lots of this kind of legislation, but we'll start specifically with late last October when a U.S. congressperson named Lamar Smith introduced the Stop Online Piracy Act, SOPA. Now, this for the large content industries, for the music industry, for the movie industry, for some of the software industry, was their number one legislative priority for the year. So I really, before I even get into the story, have to emphasize that for what is widely regarded as the most powerful lobby group in the United States, this was their number one issue. Right, this Stop Online Piracy Act. And the argument that those behind SOPA made was that there is all sorts of legislation domestically in the United States that can be used to deal with incidents of online infringement. But dealing with sites like this, sites like the Pirate Bay, represent a different sort of problem because the Pirate Bay, as you may know, is based in Sweden. And there are many sites similar to the Pirate Bay located outside of the United States, and the argument went that there was a necessity to create new laws that didn't necessarily target U.S.-based sites but would target many other sites, including sites here in Canada. Now, the reality is that the kinds of provisions that were contained in SOPA went well beyond even dealing with those foreign sites. There were significant implications for U.S.-based sites. Frankly, there were significant implications for the internet more generally. So it actually, just yesterday before the U.S. Congress, there was a hearing on internet governance issues and what is seen at times as an attempt by some U.N. agencies to try to assert greater control. Yet somewhat ironic, and the U.S. is pushing back, yet somewhat ironically, SOPA envisioned greater control and meddling within that same internet system, trying to target things like the domain name system as a mechanism to try to stop access to some of these sites, calling for website blocking, targeting various kinds of intermediaries, payment intermediaries like the credit card companies or PayPal, saying that they couldn't provide services to any number of sites that might be identified by this legislation, or advertising intermediaries like Google that provide the potential to generate some revenue and saying that they'd cut them off. Legislation even introduced a new kind of term, targeting circumvention technologies. And coming from the copyright world, I tend to think of circumvention as dealing with digital locks. It's one of the key parts of the legislation that the government is about to enact here in Canada. In this instance, circumvention technology was actually attempts to try to circumvent attempts to block access to content online. It's the same kind of technologies that are regularly used by activists and others in China to try to get around the Chinese firewall. And the notion here was that those same technologies could be used to get around the kind of website blocking that SOPA envisioned. And so the same legislation said that we're going to try to target the distribution of those kinds of technologies. On the one hand, people like Hillary Clinton running around the world saying we want to put these technologies in the hands of people in China and in other countries, and at the same time considering legislation in the United States that would actually stop the distribution of just those same kinds of technologies. Now, this, as I say, is the top issue from the top lobby group. And so within weeks, it seemed that this legislation was going to go on a fast track to being passed. There was hearings that were held. You can see the description there as a SOPA love fest. By and large, the only people who were even permitted to appear at these hearings were people who were seen as supportive of the legislation. And so, frankly, there was every reason to believe that the legislation would be passed in very short order. And yet something happened on the way to that taking place. The internet, in a sense, fought back. We had the Free Bieber campaign, which was one campaign that was rather interesting, arguing that some of the kinds of provisions in there could create a situation where Justin, from his early days, posting all sorts of YouTube videos would find potential liability. There were all sorts of online petitions raised, focusing on the censorship implications of this kind of legislation. Interestingly, this post here from a site called TechDirt was probably the most, not probably, it was the most influential post or article written on SOPA over a whole series of months. So it's written by a blogger named Mike Masnick. It's a popular site, but this particular page here of studies that have been conducted recently at Harvard identify this particular article as being linked to and cited more than any other. Not the New York Times, not the Washington Post or the LA Times or CNN or any of the mainstream media organizations, but rather TechDirt, which tells us a little bit about the changing evolution of what media looks like more generally. And just as an aside, a few days after the blackout that I'm about to talk about, there was apparently an attempt to take down that site, remove it from the Google search index using the notice and takedown system that exists in the United States just for that article alone. Masnick just happened to notice it about 3 weeks later, not realizing that that particular page had actually been removed from the index using the notice and takedown system that works in the United States. But in any event, lots of focus on these particular issues. There were various kinds of boycotts as well. The community read it. In the days just before the Christmas holidays, a list was posted of the various companies who were supportive of this legislation. One of those companies was a company called GoDaddy, which is in the domain name registration business. It's one of the largest domain name registrars in the world. They were seen as supportive of it. And so someone on Reddit said, listen, you know what, if GoDaddy is going to support this legislation running counter to my interests, I'm going to take the domain names that I register and maintain with this company and shift it elsewhere. Pretty soon there were hundreds of other people who were saying the same sort of thing. And literally within a week, GoDaddy had suddenly decided that they were no longer supportive of SOPA, as their customers had spoken out. But most powerfully within the context of the SOPA activity was this. January the 18th, my son came down in the morning for breakfast and said, Dad, why, when I took a look at the Wikipedia page this morning, this is the page that I saw. Imagine a world without free knowledge. A page that for a 24-hour period was what people encountered when they tried to access the English language version of Wikipedia, trying to highlight the implications of this legislation, not for sites like the Pirate Bay, but for sites like Wikipedia and many other legitimate sites that could face both liability and the prospect of simply not even being able to run in the way that they've traditionally run based on this kind of legislation. This particular page in that 24-hour period was viewed 162 million times, which also tells us, I think, a little bit about the importance of peer production, the importance that Wikipedia now plays in terms of basic access to information for many as a starting point, but also now about the power that we have in having created these kinds of sites to better inform the community that creates it, and the broader community as well, about what's taking place at a political level. The effect of this was first to ensure that lots of other people participated in it as well. This was news sites like Wired that were engaged in this. This is Boing Boing, a popular blog that engaged in a blackout as well. This is the Canadian version of the Huffington Post, which for 12 hours carried a blackout as well. It actually was a hot linkable blackout page. It linked to an article that I'd written arguing that Canadians ought to participate in this as well because there were implications in SOPA that extended well beyond just the United States. This is a creator site from New Zealand who engaged in the same sort of thing. So this was truly global. And the effect was dramatic. This is a page from ProPublica, which shows that on January the 18th, the day of the blackout, there were 80 members of Congress who had declared support for this legislation, only 31 against. Literally a day later, the number of supporters had diminished down to 65. The number of members of Congress who had openly come out against this legislation had tripled to over 100. And within 72 hours, the legislation was dead. The number one legislative priority of the number one lobby group in the United States defeated in about 72 hours, although, of course, there was lots of work leading up to that, by a blackout from a peer-produced encyclopedia that years ago people said wasn't credible and couldn't possibly exist as a key form of information and a source of information for others. Now, in the aftermath of this so-called SOPA story, I've gone to already too many conferences, I have to say, in the last number of months, as people begin to grapple with what is the implications of this SOPA story, because it feels, in a sense, like it's something big, right? I mean, it's quite clear when that sort of thing takes place. Now, I have to say that at a certain level, if you've been paying attention to what's been taking place here in Canada and elsewhere, there's nothing new here, particularly from a Canadian perspective. I think, for example, of what we've seen from on the copyright level here in Canada, we could go back a number of years, back to 2005, for example. Sam Bolte was a Liberal MP in the riding of Parkdale High Park. She was also the Parliamentary Secretary for Canadian Heritage. And several days before the election, this was the 2005-2006 election, the one where the election took a break for a week over the holidays and resumed in January, Several lobby groups or leaders of lobby groups, Graham Henderson, who heads the Canadian Recording Industry Association, as well as the heads of the Motion Picture Association and the Software Association and the Publisher Association, plan to hold a fundraiser for Ms. Bulte 4 days before the election was about to be held. This one of the leading people within the government deciding the very copyright rules that obviously these lobby groups were very concerned with, but so too the public was concerned with. And at that point in time, we got a bit of a taste of what might take place. So I blogged about it. A lot of other people blogged about it as well. In fact, Maclean's ultimately described it as Bulte versus the bloggers. We saw all sorts of different things begin to emerge at that time, everything from people using YouTube to as a place to post videos about what was taking place in the riding. There was a new potential MP in the riding as well by the name of Peggy Nash, who saw an opportunity there, and she began to speak out on this issue, less on the copyright, but more on the ethics involved. And it had a major impact, so that on the day of the election back in January of 2006, there were only 2 ridings in the Greater Toronto Area that flipped. That was back at the time when we seemed to be having elections every few weeks. And so there had been one fairly, just not that long, much earlier, only 2 ridings flipped. One was Olivia Chow's riding, and the other was Parkdale High Park, where a swing of more than 5,000 votes went from Ms. Bulte in the election that had taken place just 18 months earlier, now to Peggy Nash, who went ahead, who won that riding. It was clear, it was sort of that first signal that something was happening. And over the time that followed from that, we began to see groups emerge, leveraging the internet as a platform to say that the established voices weren't necessarily representing their views, and they could use the internet to find like-minded individuals and find ways to speak out on these various issues as well. By 2007, we were beginning to use social media to do the same sorts of things. This is a Facebook group that I started called Fair Copyright for Canada that succeeded in generating tens of thousands of people at a relatively, I suppose, early stage in the social media game. With an impact that the government didn't quite know what to make of these sorts of activities and thus actually delayed legislation by 6 months, not introducing it due to the kind of pressure that they were facing. It led to people going offline as well and trying to encounter the then industry minister, Jim Prentice, on the issue. Tens of thousands of people sending physical letters to the government on these issues. Local groups, including groups right here in Vancouver, finding one another either through Facebook or otherwise, and literally meeting on a weekly or sometimes monthly basis to talk about where this copyright bill was going and talk about the kinds of things they could do to try to challenge it and ensure that their voices were better heard. We used other sorts of tools as well, Google Maps to highlight the media coverage, to identify whether it was negative or positive, and allow people to better understand that. Things like calendaring software online for people to know when these local events were taking place. You could even get t-shirts and mugs, which I still have some in my closet and my wife won't let me wear. But nevertheless, we had that. So you get all kinds of swag around Fair Copyright for Canada. We did a YouTube contest. There were all sorts of different things. Again, relatively early, but beginning to demonstrate that there was an impact. And we saw the same sort of thing, and Steve alluded to it a few minutes ago in his introduction around the issue of usage-based billing, when in 2010 there was a sense that the CRTC had taken this issue around usage-based billing, the idea of metering, in a sense, internet services, and this too was a dead certainty in the same way, I suppose, that SOPA was. But yet, once again, we saw using these sorts of tools in effective ways. And this is the petition that Steve was referring to, where open media played such an important role in demonstrating that there were an awful lot of Canadians who were interested and concerned with these sorts of issues, so much so that, again, in relatively rapid, at a very rapid pace, the government began to flip and say, hold on a second, we're not comfortable with where the CRTC is going on this issue. In fact, it's not just in Canada. The idea of a blackout dates almost to the very earliest days of the web. Back in 1996, the U.S. Congress introduced the Communications Decency Act, which actually had some elements of the legislation that survive until today and are quite important. They're quite good. But there were other elements there that were very problematic, raising real concerns about freedom of speech, a designation of so-called obscene content, legislation that was later struck down by the U.S. Supreme Court as unconstitutional. But at that point in time, a number of groups back in 96 urged everyone to black out their websites. This is from the group CDT, which was engaged in that. But at the time, we didn't have the hundreds of millions that we have now. It was instead tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands engaged. In fact, even more recently, we've seen blackouts in places like New Zealand around copyright legislation just a couple of years ago, where people were encouraged not to black out their website, but rather simply their profile, whether on Facebook or on Twitter, wherever their profile might exist. And the impact, again, had the similar kind of impact that we saw here in Canada, where the government in New Zealand delayed legislation. This was the so-called three strikes and you're out rules, the idea that three allegations of infringement could result in someone being kicked off the internet, having their internet service terminated. And the New Zealand government ultimately went back to the drawing board, ultimately still coming up with legislation that allows for that, but does so with far more due process than was initially envisioned. In fact, this wasn't even the only time we'd seen a Wikipedia-based blackout. There was one just last year in Italy, where in a protest against a media law in Italy, the Italian language Wikipedia blacked out for the day. So all of this is to say that at a certain level, this is nothing new. In fact, you know, not that Time magazine is particularly prescient. I don't think it quite clearly is not. But if we look at the last 2 years of their so-called People of the Year, Mark Zuckerberg 2 years ago, the protester was last year. What we're talking about is all about the combination of protest plus social media and the kind of impact that it can have. If Time magazine can see this and get this, then surely this is at a certain level not exactly a huge surprise. We've seen this before. So if it's nothing new, what's the SOPA story? Well, I'd argue that the SOPA story is actually not what took place now with SOPA, but what we have seen in the aftermath of SOPA, what we've seen in just a few months since the event that I started with took place. For example, there's the Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Agreement, ACTA. So ACTA dates back as a concept back to about 2004. Back in 2007, the Canadian government announced that it was going to introduce legislation, it was going to participate in these discussions, and many critics, myself included, focused on the secrecy associated with ACTA, with the Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Agreement. Yet nevertheless, the negotiations went on, and by 2010, Canada, the United States, European countries, and a number of Asian countries had agreed to this Anti-Counterfeiting Trade Agreement. By last October, many, though not all, of the countries had signed. This is Ed Fast, our Minister of International Trade, in Tokyo last October, signing ACTA on behalf of Canada. There's no European flags up there because due to a bit of a procedural fluke, the European countries weren't in a position to sign at that October meeting. The expectation instead was that they would sign in fairly short order, and indeed most, though not all, European countries signed 9 days after the SOPA blackout. Now, once again, the European countries didn't think that much would happen here. They had signed, the agreement had been agreed to, many other countries had signed as well. And yet within days, these are pictures from the streets of Poland, where tens of thousands of people took to the streets over a copyright agreement. In fact, in the weeks and months that would follow, hundreds of thousands of people would take to the streets in Germany and elsewhere, not just the streets, but in Parliament as well. This is the Polish Parliament, where opposition MPs donned Guy Fawkes masks as a message of protest against the particular legislation. Almost immediately, the rapporteur within the European Parliament, the last place where this agreement could be needed approval within Europe, quit, saying this was all just theater and a circus and he wasn't going to continue to participate. There was an attempt to try to delay it by the European Commission, yet just yesterday, three of the major committees looking at this issue within the European Parliament recommended not ratifying it, and one of the leading European commissioners has already, within the last couple of weeks, declared ACTA all but dead. We don't stop agreements that the United States and Europe and Japan and Canada agree to and go through all sorts of difficulties in terms of protests along the way, and yet that's exactly what has happened just in the last number of months. There's also the Research Works Act, the RWA, which focuses on the issue of open access. The notion that, particularly for publicly funded research, if the public funds it, it ought to be made available on an open and free basis to the same people that have funded this very research. We've seen mandates to do that in countries around the world, where funders of research say, if we're going to provide you with funding, publish wherever you like, but ensure that your work is made available on the internet so that others can access it. There's been pushback from major publishers, though, and so around the same time that SOPA was introduced, legislation was introduced that would have prohibited the U.S. government agencies from mandating this sort of open access approach. And yet once again, the internet fought back. Thousands of researchers, the very ones who contribute both the work, do the peer review, and often provide the editorial work, all for no payment at all, said they wouldn't provide any of that to any Elsevier journals, the leading publisher in the space, so long as they supported the RWA, they supported the Research Works Act. The media picks up on this story as it becomes also a matter of international focus, and within about a month of the boycott site, Elsevier announces that it's no longer supporting the RWA. In fact, those against it were so emboldened that about 10 days ago, they launched a petition on the White House website, where if 25,000 people sign this petition, the U.S. government will have to respond to it, arguing that not only should we not be putting legislation that stops this from taking place, we actually need legislation that's the exact flip. We need legislation that makes it very clear that all U.S. government-funded research is made available under open access. They're only a few thousand signatures away. If you haven't signed, go visit the site, and please do so today. There's Bill C-30, which we heard reference to during the introduction, the so-called internet surveillance or lawful access, or as the government called it, the Protecting Children from Internet Predators Act, despite the fact that in the 100-page bill, that's the only place where you see the word children. Now, this legislation was legislation that, as you know, over a decade in the making, and every reason to believe that it would pass also in fairly short order. In fact, so confident was the government and Public Safety Minister Vic Tase that it would pass that the day before the bill was introduced, he was asked about it in the House of Commons, and as he infamously stated, you can either stand with us or you can stand with the child pornographers. Now, as many in the room will know, many Canadians decided that if that was the choice, they would stand with the child pornographers. And so what we found was many, using things like Open Media's site, Ontario Privacy Commissioner Anne Cavoukian, finding ways for people to speak out on this issue. The Liberals launched one of their own petitions as well. Lots of different groups all trying to raise awareness and speak out against these issues. Notable bloggers trying to inform and build upon some of the kind of work that, as you heard, the BCCLA has been involved with. We had other sorts of instances as well. We had the WikiLeaks, which attracted a fair amount of controversy. Better, I think, was the Tell Vic Everything campaign that Steve alluded to, the sort of where people would tell just about any, tell Vic, if Vic was going to engage in this sort of surveillance, you might as well use Twitter just to tell him just about anything. Here's what I had for breakfast and the like, which I recognize some people think that's what you say on Twitter anyway. But in fact, it's not typically what you say. My favorite here was, you know, I accidentally deleted an email last night. Vic, can I have your copy? Which I thought, in 140 characters, did a remarkably good job of, in a funny way, hammering home some of the concerns associated with this legislation. And while Vic Tay said he found it funny, when they're laughing at you, that's not a particularly good position to be in from a political perspective. And so within about 2 weeks, the legislation was, as you heard from Steve, the pause button was placed on that legislation. It's possible that it will return. But I would suspect that Vic Tase in particular is so now negatively associated with this legislation that at a minimum it's going to take a cabinet shuffle in order for that to happen. Remarkable to see how that has changed. Lest you think that this is solely about digital-related issues, people like Coney, Joseph Coney, are now household names, at least in my household, where a viral video campaign from a group in California ran against everything that everyone tells you you're supposed to do when it comes to video viral campaigns on the internet. They're only supposed to be 2 or 3 minutes long. Nobody has the patience to watch a 30-minute video about a wanted African war criminal. And yes, this video has been viewed over 100 million times, making it a household name, particularly amongst younger demographics, as they use social media in particular to raise awareness around Joseph Kony. And though there has been some question as to whether or not this was the right target, Reuters reported just a week or so ago, this from the head of the UN regional office in the area, that the overall impact has been very positive, since millions are now informed about the consequences of what Coney is doing, and it shows you just how deep the awareness has gone. So there's Coney as a household name. There's, of course, Trayvon as a household name as well. Much of that also fueled yet another, just what might have been just another murder that or killing that takes place in the United States seemingly on a far too regular basis. And yet, once again, social media plays an important role of taking this particular incident, raising awareness, and suddenly Trayvon too becomes a household name. Or finally, within our own communities here in Canada with the Quebec students, where there's all sorts of questions, of course, about the legislation that the Quebec government, Bill 78, that they've introduced, differences of views about the position of the students, I suppose, not a whole lot of difference of opinion about 78. But nevertheless, it starts with just a few students. Once again, I mean, all these stories just start with a few people in the same way that they start, I suppose, around a dinner table saying that we ought to be doing something about these issues. In this instance, a few people show up after the budget is introduced back in March of last year saying they're concerned with where tuition is going. The protests begin to grow and grow some more this year, and it's social media that once again plays an enormous role. In fact, the former, now former, education minister in Quebec, Lynn Bouchon, is quoted a couple of weeks ago in a Radio Canada interview as saying, part of the predicament stemmed from a failure to anticipate the impact of social media on the dynamics of the standoff. Now, that's what we've seen take place in the last number of weeks. And if I've been given the note that I've just got a couple of minutes, I take three things from this. The first, in response in particular to the Quebec minister, is that you don't get to fail to anticipate the impact of social media anymore. I think that's true certainly for government and policymakers. I think it is true as well for anyone that seeks to advocate and work in the space on behalf of digital rights or civil rights more generally. Social media raises all sorts of concerns. I appeared before the Ethics Committee at the House of Commons just yesterday on privacy implications of social media. There are concerns there. But its power and potential to bring together literally millions of people on these issues, giving them a voice and a sense of community and an impact, is something that cannot be ignored if you hope to have an impact. The second thing I take from all of this is just to remind that from the days of the Wikipedia blackout until today, we are talking about roughly 18 weeks. 18 weeks to take down a treaty like ACTA, to stop a bill like Bill C-30, to stop legislation like the RWA, to see the escalation of protests like we've seen them in Quebec, and to make household names of people like Coney and Trayvon. If we can do that in 18 weeks, think of what the broader implications will be about the SOPA blackout, where from a policy perspective, many of these things take time. The short-term effects are sometimes to stop legislation. The longer-term effects in terms of changing what some of these rules look like happen over years, and we're just at the very, very beginning of all of that. Finally, though, that's the optimistic side to the story. The somewhat less optimistic side to the story is that if this is the year that the internet fought back, this is a series of wins on a series of battles, but the war, in a sense, continues. Whether it's trade agreements like the Canada-EU trade agreement, or the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, both trade agreements that contain all sorts of intellectual property provisions, both copyright provisions, patent provisions that affect things like access to medicines and the like, all of which would undo much of the sort of good that we're able to fight against in some of these other bills. ACTA may be dead, or so it would seem, in Europe, but we signed. And in fact, there is still an expectation that here in Canada, we will change our laws to ensure that they're ACTA compliant. Lobby groups in the United States are already talking about a SOPA 2, bringing legislation like SOPA back again. And Bill C-30, as I mentioned, may be on hiatus. It may require a change in minister, but it is likely to come back. Those that are in support of this sort of legislation have been fighting for this for well over a decade now and aren't going to stop just with the incidents that we saw over the last number of months. So there's a lot of good and a lot, I think, of exciting opportunities that we've seen take place over the last period of time. But for those engaged in these issues, I suppose the real message of what we've seen with respect to SOPA and ACTA and all these different activities is that we're going to have to keep fighting. Thanks very much for your attention.
Can take some questions? Thank you so very, very kindly. We have time for a few questions. I will bring the microphone to you. Are the people who would like to ask questions of Dr. Geist? I'll be right. Of course, you'd be right at the back.
Abbas had an E, father of Sablefish, father of all women, Raven tribe, Ganhada. I got here late, so I don't know if the territory was acknowledged. If it was, thank you. Do you feel that Facebook is still overvalued?
Well, I didn't buy. let's put it that way. I'm not a business guy to be able to answer that question in terms of the pricing of Facebook. What I would say is that the implications of what we've seen with Facebook over the last couple of weeks as it's gone public, and especially the revelations that from a business perspective is there's a strong shift to mobile, the ability for that company to generate revenue from what is seen as its traditional source of revenue, traditional, it's a short time, but conventionally just basic advertising, is going to be under great pressure. What that will mean for shareholders is, and for the company itself, is that they've got to find new ways to make money. If advertising isn't going to do it, you and me and anyone else who happens to be on Facebook are going to be where the sources of revenue are going to come from. The pressures to monetize and use our personal information in new ways to generate revenues, if advertising doesn't do it, is only going to escalate. So while I can't give you stock advice on this, what I can tell you is that I think that the privacy issues that Facebook has already created, I think, in the minds of many, are only going to escalate as the company now is public and faces ever more pressure to generate returns for its multi-billion dollar valuation.
Sorry, another question up front, and then I'll come back to the back.
Isn't this a whole issue between the, I use it euphemistically, the 99% versus the power 1%?
Well, I mean, certainly in terms of sheer numbers, you can look at it that way. Clearly, there's, you know, the overwhelming voice that we've seen on many of these issues sort of strikes one as the 99%. At the same time, I'd say the impact here is very real and sometimes in a positive way, right? Not just in stopping treaties, but also in changing some of the rules too. So I didn't have a chance to, for example, get into the substance on copyright. But if we were to take a look at the impact from some of those early days, whether it's the Sam Bolte story or the Facebook story and stuff like that, I mentioned that it takes a few years for the pressure points to begin to show themselves from a policy perspective. And in fact, we've seen that in the copyright side. So the copyright bill is not perfect. In fact, there's some real problems with it around digital locks, very, very significant problems. But the bill that the government's about to pass is massively better than it was back in 2007. And I'd argue that's largely a function of those voices speaking out and sending a message to the government that there's concerns there. So while I don't typically think of it as the 1% and the 99%, what I do see is that there is real potential both from a short-term perspective to not just have attention but try to stop some of the worst in its tracks, but also perhaps just as importantly or maybe even more importantly, make, I think, positive big changes from a policy perspective, though those take longer and they take real effort, sustained effort, and sometimes that's more difficult to achieve.
Question here at the back.
Thank you very much for sharing your knowledge. I wanted to ask you two questions. One is, what lessons can be learned from the social media used in the Arab Spring? Because the Egyptian elections show quite a bit of a hiccup. And the second question is, what can raging grandparents do about participating in social media? Because we had raging grannies who did a wonderful job protesting against the war. Thank you.
Sure. So I'm glad you raised that, because I think that the, you know, in some ways, obviously, that Time magazine protester cover points to exactly what you're saying, that we've seen this in a sense with the Arab Spring as well. We also see some of the dangers of using social media in those kinds of contexts, too, though, where the same governments that can be influenced and have an impact, as we saw in countries like Egypt and Tunisia, can seek to use some of these same sorts of tools against the very people who are using them. And so one example in Tunisia would be that for quite a while, Facebook was being used by many as a mechanism for messaging. And the government was seeking to intercept all of that messaging as it was going in and out. And Facebook was not choosing as its default a level of encryption within those emails that would make it more difficult to intercept and identify. They gradually changed as a result of that. But the prospect that government can use social media, governments in those kind of circumstances can use it as a mechanism to identify people, to target those very people, to, in a sense, use these tools against them, is, I think, a very real concern and a very real worry. And so while there's, I think, a lot of good that comes out of this, at the same time, there is the potential for misuse, both by the companies themselves and potentially by the authorities as well.
Okay.
I'm interested in your thoughts about the future role of Anonymous, the movie coming out this summer, and the potential blowback from mainstream communities about kind of their concern and their difficulty in understanding the hacktivist ethic.
Yeah, no, that's a good question. And, you know, I guess my view is that I think there's, the negative connotations that have often come from the term hacker has been, I think a problem for years, in part because the roles that hackers can play from a positive perspective, whether to identify security breaches or a range of different things, is enormously positive. And there has been a real effort, of course, to undermine that, to, in a sense, label anyone as a hacker in the same way that anybody that may engage in remix art or something like that is described as a pirate in many instances. And so there's a real issue there. The problem that I have at times with Anonymous is that where you are taking down sites that are legitimate sites, free speech, that are themselves engaging in legitimate speech, even if it is speech that you disagree with, from my perspective, this raises the same concerns that I would have if those tools were used to stop the kinds of voices that I want to see take place, the misuse of takedown. And so at times what I see Anonymous engaging in are taking down sites from organizations that I disagree with, but I don't disagree with their rights to say what they want to say. And my view would be that where that happens, there is a need to speak out against the tactics of Anonymous, because everybody is entitled to that freedom of speech, whether we like it or not.
Sorry, the last question over here was yours. Oh, sorry, yours.
I was wondering if you could expand on what the impact of the RWA would have been and how it would have hurt the legitimacy of research.
Sure. So open access is a movement that has grown remarkably in the last decade. And the basic idea behind it, as I mentioned, is the current business model for many large business publishers, is journal publishers, is that researchers conduct research, they send their articles to journals that conduct peer review of those journals, and then they publish it and then sell those journals back, sometimes for thousands of dollars per year for a subscription, back to the very institutions where the researchers were working. And so we're paying for especially where the public is funding this research, we pay for the research and then we pay to buy back the very research that we have turned around and funded. And the inputs for all of this, the research, the peer review, the editorial boards, that's all done by the same academics, and they do it all typically for no payment whatsoever. So in a sense, it's just paying an intermediary, in this case, the publisher. Over the last 10 years, there's been a recognition that the internet changes this, or has the potential to change this, by taking those same works, making them openly and freely available. Sometimes through journals that are open access to begin with, it's called gold open access, where they are free and openly available from the moment of publication. At other times through what's known as green open access. And green open access says publish in whatever journal you like, Lancet, New England Journal of Medicine, doesn't matter, whatever it happens to be, but within 6 months typically of publication, make a copy of that journal article openly and freely available on the internet. That's typically the condition. And so there's the freedom to publish where you like, but at the same time, the public gets access to this. Now, many, many researchers are moving in this direction. Some estimates say about 30% of all research is now published under open access. So there's a huge amount, literally millions of articles that are now openly available. But what we still find is that mandates work better than trying to persuade people and educate people about this issue. So where you get a grant, and the grant, as a condition of the grant, says you've got to make this available under open access, that's typically more effective than trying to go from faculty to faculty to convince people to do this. And so a growing number of funders in the UK, in Europe, in the United States are moving in this direction. In fact, one large European Union initiative with billions of dollars behind it says they're moving to mandatory open access in the next year or two. This, from a publisher perspective, is seen as a threat, because if the stuff is openly available, the value add that they bring in all this is somewhat limited. And so RWA sought to pull back the effort of groups like the NIH, the National Institutes of Health in the United States, from moving towards mandatory open access. And the pushback against RWA said, hold on a second, we're the ones that are providing the inputs, we're the ones that are doing the peer review, we're the ones that are providing the editorial work, and it's the public that's paying for all of this to begin with. What makes sense in this circumstance is to ensure that the public enjoys access. And so what will hopefully come out of all of this is not just to have stopped RWA, but actually now increasingly move towards a more positive agenda that says we want to see countries, including our own, move towards mandatory open access as simply a cost of doing business. If you're a researcher and you don't want to make it available that way, then don't take the money. But if you're going to take thousands of dollars or sometimes millions of dollars in public funding to help fund the research, I think it's a pretty reasonable request to say that a copy of that research is ultimately made available to the very public that funded it.
Okay. So we're just going to bring this part of the program to a wrap by me saying that if the BCCLA thinks that you're really fantastic, the way we reward you for that is to asking you to do work for us or with us. Sorry about that. It's kind of a crap deal on that end. But you also get mountains of our gratitude, our thanks, and a little bit of swag. Thank you very much, Dr. Geist. Thank you very much, Steve Anderson.
Thank you.
I just wanted to take this brief minute to say we're live tweeting the event, and our hashtag is BCCLA50th, 50th. So for those of you on the net.
My job is to welcome our next introducer, actually, before Cindy Blackstock speaks. In my opinion and in the association's experience, First Nations communities, Indigenous people in BC and Canada, both on and off reserve, are the communities that face the greatest civil liberties threats, whether it be policing, privacy, or just basic access to human rights that we all take for granted. The stories that I've heard in my travels in the north and in my time in the downtown east side from Indigenous people are shocking and continue to be shocking. The stories of Frank Paul, Clayton Alvin Wiley, the tens of murdered and missing Indigenous women who met with little or no police response. These are all very live issues. The Robert Jakansky Inquiry, the province struck a special committee to implement every single recommendation. The Frank Paul Inquiry, we are still waiting on implementation of, as far as I know, even one recommendation from that public inquiry. And so it is with great honor for me to be able to introduce a partner of the associations and a critical partner in our work to work with the Indigenous community in BC and Canada, both on and off reserve, and a champion of rights for that community and a very esteemed leader, Grand Chief Stuart Phillip of the Union of BC Indian Chiefs, who will introduce Cindy Blackstock. Thank you.
Why Huskahel Pisinaxil and Chaya Squeeze Asil. Good day, my relatives. My traditional name is Asil. I'm a member of the Penticton Indian Band, St. Pinkton, and a proud member of the Okanagan Nation, which is comprised of 7 First Nations up in the beautiful, sunny Okanagan and Smelkameen Valleys. I want to begin by acknowledging the Coast Salish peoples, the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh, on whose traditional lands we have the privilege and the honor of gathering for this important dialogue that we're having here today. And I would like to congratulate the BC Civil Liberties Association for their good work. They have certainly proven themselves to be a very valuable and honorable friend of the First Nations in the province of British Columbia and have helped us to give public expression to many of the issues that confront First Nations communities throughout this province in terms of police brutality, the missing and murdered women issue, and a whole array of social justice issues. And over the years, I've had the privilege of working with Mr. Eby, He's definitely a close friend of the UBCIC, and we've spent a lot of hours together over the last several years, rallying in front of the Vancouver police station, marching through the streets of Vancouver in the pouring rain, at just a whole number of rallies and marches and candlelight vigils. And Mr. Eby, as some of you may know, has traveled throughout the province investigating the injustices within the criminal justice system as it applies to Aboriginal people, and it's quite shocking. I'm somewhat upset with myself that I didn't get here earlier to hear the presenter. It sounded very fascinating. Actually, I'm between protests at the moment. Yesterday, I had the honor of being out on the bridge in the Arthur Lang Bridge at the North End. We were supporting the Musqueam people in their courageous and principled stand in terms of defending the sacred burial site of their ancestors. And it was an interesting morning. It was incredibly wet. But the movement down underneath the Arthur Lang Bridge at the North End is being led by women, two sisters in particular, Cecilia and Mary Point. And they have been there huddled under that bridge in all kinds of weather for the last month, attempting to seek a resolve of that outrageous situation, where there's a developer alongside the province and investors attempting to continue desecrating that burial site for the purposes of building a five-story condo development. And as I heard your previous speaker, I thought this whole matter of social media, and believe me, I started relying on phone booths, Gestetner machines, carbon paper, you know where the CC came from, and so-called snail mail. And I never dreamed that we would be in touch around this world within a few seconds of incidents happening. And when I reflect back on our involvement in the Oka conflict, we had one cell phone in our community in Penticton, and it was about this big. It was a two-hander. And the amazing thing, there was always 60 or 70 people at the blockade site in our home community. It was a solidarity blockade. And when that cell phone would ring, panic would set in. There was only one person that knew how to operate it. And amazingly, all you had to do was push a button that said, talk. And we'd be yelling this person's name. His name was Greg, to come and answer the phone. And I also thought, wouldn't it be interesting to consider the tweets that Sitting Bull might have sent out, or Martin Luther King, or Malcolm X, or any of those great leaders pursuing issues of social justice. It would be quite amazing. This afternoon, we're going to be out in front of Taseko Mines Limited with the Salkotin people, once again fighting back on the Prosperity 2 project at 837 Hastings, West Hastings. So I just want to let you know how valuable we believe the BCCLA to be in terms of helping us with our struggle, with our ongoing struggle, diametrically opposed values that we hold near and dear to our heart with respect to the land, the waters, and our people, as opposed to the values that Mr. Harper holds near and dear to his heart and his cronies in industry, which are warmly snuggled in Bill C-38 And we'll be out on the streets with respect to that issue on Monday, along with a lot of other concerned citizens of this country that no one understand the very values that fashioned this great country are at risk under this government. So kudos to the BCCLA and people like Mr. Eby, who is very much like the you know, the bunny that goes along beating the drum there. I'm here this morning to introduce Dr. Cindy Blackstock, who I became aware of several years ago. She came to speak at a Child at the Center conference in British Columbia, which featured all of the First Nations communities, our Aboriginal organizations who had gathered in regard to the deep concerns we carry with respect to the well-being of our children in our communities, whether that be rural or urban, and the complete disparity of funding for the delivery of services to our children that are completely below the level of funding that support other children programs and services delivered by the provincial governments and the federal government. And I just spoke to our chief as I came down here this morning. He's the face of the new leadership in Indian country, so to speak. I'm 62 years old. I was a member of the Penticton and Indian Band Council for 24 years. Spent 24 years in that boardroom, 10 as a band counselor, 14 as the band chief. And I began speaking to the grandparents, and during my tenure I was speaking to the parents. And when the grandchildren came in and were complaining about the same issues, I thought, it's time to move on. It's time to allow somebody else to step into the circle of leadership, somebody with new insights, new vision, and new energy. And our chief is a very dynamic leader, like all young chiefs are. They're seeking results. They're tired of excuses. And I told him where I was going. And he's going to attend a few meetings today, and then he's going to support a youth unity run through the West Kootenays, the Okanagan, up through to Revelstoke. And there are scores of our young people that are involved in that run. It's an annual event, and it was triggered by tragedy, by a triple homicide in our community that was drug-related, related to the sponsor gangs at the top that fight over turf, and they use the reserve system as an outlet and a distribution center for drugs because it's so difficult to police Native Reserve communities. And these young people have taken it upon themselves to carry forward this run to raise awareness about the mental health issues and the epidemic suicide rates in our communities with young people. And that starts with children. And it starts with the fact that more children have been apprehended, like myself. I was apprehended when I was about a year old and placed into care than ever went through the residential school system. And that's when I met Cindy Blackstock, Dr. Cindy Blackstock, who was one of our featured speakers at Child at the Center One. And I first was quite annoyed when she took to the stage because I've never really heard anybody speak like her before. And she was up there striding back and forth with this little boom mic on, yelling at us. And I was thinking, who the hell is this person here? Like, who is this lady? You know, where did she come from? But you're pretty much compelled to listen to her message or leave the room. You have a choice. And I started to listen to what she had to say. And it was incredible. It was the stark truth. I remember one of the first things she said. She said, "The first thing we need to know and understand is we must protect our children from ourselves." And there was so many torch carriers in the whole room that, you know, pretty much had made their careers on their various positions with respect to child welfare. And the second thing that I remember that Dr. Cindy Blackstock said, which really has stayed with me, is no economy, no child care. And that's the situation in First Nations communities because of our economic marginalization and the disparity. So I followed Dr. Cindy Blackstock in her career as a champion for the fundamental human rights of children across this country, and taking on the government of Canada at the highest levels to the point where she was under RCMP surveillance. And she actually had people following her around on the streets and keeping track of her movements, and because she was causing the Canada's reputation to come under the microscope at the international level. And I can't say enough about leaders, activists that do the work that Dr. Cindy Blackstock has been able to undertake as effectively as she has. And I have a very special place in my heart for women, because it's the women that bear the heavy burden of poverty in all of our communities. It's the women that bear the heartbreak of the poverty and the violence that flows and stems from the fundamental issue of poverty. And I've always believed that women have a unique gift to be able to get into the face of government. We saw it at the Crown First Nation Gathering when Regional Chief Jody Wilson-Raybould said, "With all due respect, Mr. Prime Minister, I disagree." And it became known in the PMO's office as the "with all due respect" speech. And there was a big furor about how she had totally disrespected the Prime Minister's office. But Dr. Cindy Blackstock is definitely a leader in our world. And I have 12 grandchildren, six of which are granddaughters, and I feel not only inspired but greatly encouraged with respect to the work that you do. And I know in my heart that you are making a difference. And I urge you to continue your good work, to continue to give expression to your important message, and anything we can do to support you, please don't hesitate to call on us for that support. So it's a great honor to be privileged to welcome somebody such as Dr. Cindy Blackstock. Why? Lim Lim.
I have to say that the Grand Chief is one of my heroes. You are a child in a wealthy country. You get a fifth less education than everybody else. You get a fifth less opportunity to grow up safely in your family. You get almost no health care. Sometimes you don't even have a tap to turn on a clean glass of water in a country that has the most clean water in the world. You may not have safe food to eat. You may have toxic waste dumps or environmental damage being done by industry. And all of it is because of your race. And as you look around at the many human rights and academics and government people that are supposed to uphold the value of human rights in a country like Canada, you find your story is an uncomfortable interruption into the conversation of the privileged. Filling the back chapters of human rights reports, often framed as if this was the way it has always been. and yet the racial discrimination against children by a country as well developed as Canada would be headline news around the world. Sometimes feels like nobody is watching. But the non-Aboriginal children are. The non-Aboriginal children look over to that racial discrimination against First Nations children, and they know that it's not fair. They are not baffle-gabbed by speeches by government officials that say the situation is complex. They will not buy into a country like ours where racial discrimination is easier for governments to implement than equality. They will not stand by and say that they're so worried that they'll do the wrong thing that they'll do nothing at all. They are not overcome with shame that leaves them immobilized. They listen to the national anthem and they hear that line, "O Canada, we stand on guard for thee," and they know what it means. They know what it means. It doesn't mean just showing up on November 11th. Now, where does these inequalities come from? Well, as Sheila Fraser and many others before have said, and as the Grand Chief has just noticed, provincial child welfare, education, and health laws have displaced wrongfully traditional forms of governance and laws that First Nations have kept their kids safe for thousands of years. So they apply on and off reserve, but the federal government is supposed to fund it. And when the federal government does so, often to a far lesser standard, provinces like British Columbia do not top it up. I was a child welfare worker over in the North Shore of Vancouver. And I remember being overwrought by the limited level of resources we had for non-Aboriginal kids. And then I stepped across 3rd Street into the Squamish Nation. It was like a completely different world. And the crazy thing is that the non-Aboriginal population often had the stereotype that we got the more on reserve than everybody else. And we have this whole language around First Nations that allows that stereotype to continue. We make these racist words into benefits, such as status cards, which is really just cover for measuring people's blood quantum to determine whether the government of Canada recognizes for who you are. We have governments that talk a lot about how much they spend on First Nations peoples without calling attention to the fact that that's far less than they would receive if they were non-Aboriginal. And so it has been that the Canadian government and the province of British Columbia have gotten away with this for years. Now, what are the impacts and who is taking a stand? This is Shannon Kustachin. And as you can see, she cannot vote in the Canadian elections. In this picture, she's 13 years old. But when she was a girl in kindergarten, she had the dream that many in this room had. She wanted to learn. She wanted to go to a proper school. But the only school in her community was closed because it sat on a toxic waste dump of 30,000 gallons of diesel fuel having leaked into the ground because of a broken heating pipe. For over 20 years, the children and teachers and staff and members of the parent community were complaining because the people were getting sick in the school. But nobody listened until an independent assessment found it to be a toxic waste dump so contaminated that it was dangerous to remove even the school books from the school. So when Shannon was 5 years old, the Canadian government brought up portable trailers and put them on the playground of that contaminated school, separated only by a chain-length fence, a distance between the kindergarten portable and that contamination no further from where I stand to the back wall. It was a temporary measure, the government of Canada said. It wouldn't be too long at all before the children would get a school. And Shannon saw two political parties take power, 3 ministers of Indian Affairs promised a new school, and nothing happened. Except the portables were getting more and more run down. It would often be 20 below zero in the portables because the heat would be turned off. Or that you would have to take your lunch to your desk to protect it against the rats. And children with that were getting a lot of things like asthma because they had respiratory problems due to the black mold contamination in the portables. And yet every morning at 8 o'clock in the morning, Shannon and her friends would meet outside one of the portables. And they would lift a little boy that was in a wheelchair up the stairs so that he could learn. Because there was no wheelchair access. Now, what did she do with this? Did she hope that groups would finally take up the cause? Would she hope that the politicians would make another promise and keep it? Well, she decided to take action. She encouraged all the younger children in the school to write letters to the government of Canada. She believed that they must be not giving them a proper school because they don't know how bad it is. She saw children as young as 10 drop out of high school or elementary school because they had no hope. You got to remember, this is a community with one potable source of water, where people are living in tents. Where people are living in tents, and this is in your country. Well, the government of Canada didn't listen to the letters by the children, so Shannon tried something else. She believed in the goodness of the non-Aboriginal children, so she created a YouTube video and she sent it out into the universe, and to her surprise, thousands of non-Aboriginal children responded. They could see what many adults could not see, is that there is absolutely no excuse, as my mother would say, no excuse for a child being left behind. And so it was that thousands of letters filled up the mailbox of the government of Canada. But that didn't help either. Halfway through Shannon's grade 8 year, the government of Canada sends a letter to the kids of Attawapiskat saying, no school for you, we cannot afford it. The grade 8 class decided they would meet. They had fundraised for their trip for their grade 8 graduation. They decided they were going to cancel it. They're going to cancel it and use the money to send three kids down to meet with the Minister of Indian Affairs. One was Shannon Kustachin. And as Shannon would later say, she thinks the minister was nervous. Because ministers may know how to deal with NGOs, and they may know how to deal with political parties, but even they are beguiled by the force of 13-year-olds. And I think he probably was nervous, because he opens up his door, and the first thing he says is, he points out how nice and big his office is over there at 10 Wellington. And Shannon, being an observant and bright little girl, says, yes, it is nice, and I wish it was this warm for those of us learning in Attawapiskat. By this time, she knew that every First Nations child in the country was underfunded in education by $2,000 to $3,000 a year, even if you had a good school, and that there were horrible schools in deplorable condition in every region of the country. Here in British Columbia, children are suffering with black mold contamination and overcrowding. In Manitoba, infestations of snakes. And hers is not the only school to sit next to a toxic waste dump. So the minister goes on and he starts looking at his watch, as ministers do, because you're supposed to be grateful to get any time at all with a minister. I don't know why, because they really don't do much when you meet with them. But we are, when they're kind of like rats to a thing, we're just grateful to be in their company. And he was looking at his watch. And she says, look, are you going to give us a school or not? And he said, no, I can't afford it. And this graceful 13-year-old stands and rises, and she says, I don't believe you. And I will never give up, because school is a time for dreams, and every kid deserves this. That's Shannon Kustachin 2 hours after that meeting with the government, telling the world what she had told the minister. She went on to be nominated for the International Children's Peace Prize, given out by the Nobel laureates, one of only 45 kids in the world to be so honored. And at the age of 15, hundreds of miles away from her family, trying to get an education so that she could go to law school, Shannon Kustachin dies in an automobile accident, never having seen proper education for herself or for her friends. On the same day of her passing, the many thousands of children she inspired created a Facebook page called Shannon's Dream, where they memorialized this young hero and pledged to continue her work until every child in the country had a proper education. And that you can join Shannon's Dream and sign on as well with the kids and the supporters. And it's important that you do, because the discrimination fettered out by Canada towards First Nations children is not topic dependent. It cuts across all areas of experience. This is Jordan River Anderson. He was caught in a jurisdictional dispute between Manitoba and Canada. They were arguing over who should pay for a government service that would allow him to be discharged from hospital, a government service that would be provided without question to any other child in the country. He ends up staying in hospital for over 2.5 years unnecessarily while governments argue over who should pay. He dies tragically, never having spent a day in a family home and never knowing what it is to be treated equally, to be treated as a child, to be treated as a human being like all other Canadians are by his own government. And what does this family do? They ask that this not happen to other children, and we know it is to thousands of children in every region of the country, that they are denied or delayed receipt of services because of their race as governments fight over who should pay. I should say that the federal government was running a $22 billion surplus at the time they were trying to protect the taxpayer against taking up the expenses that it would cost to bring Jordan back to his home. And I have yet to find one taxpayer, including myself, who would have been upset that my dollars would have went to giving that child the same level of service that all other Canadians enjoy. Not one. But Jordan's principle applies to all government services. Not to services that are special for First Nations, but to all government services to children. It says, when a government service is available and one of these crazy disputes arises, the government of first contact, feds or province, pay for the service and argue about it later. Now, has the government of Canada implemented it? Of course not. Marina Beadle would tell you that. She's an elder, and as you can plainly see, she's a mother as well of two young men, and that is Jeremy in the photograph. Jeremy is 15 years old, and if Marina were here, she would want to tell you first about all the wonderful things and the great joy that Jeremy brings to her life and to her nation's life. He loves art and he loves music. What is equally true is he has cerebral palsy and autism and hydrocephalus, which results in severe self-harming behavior. Now, Marina, with almost no supports, because we all know about the difficulties that persons with disabilities have off reserve, but it's even magnified that much more on reserve. She cares for him until he's 15 years of age, without any complaints, with only a heart full of love. She would tell me that she always slept lightly because she always wanted to hear if Jeremy could hear her, needed her in any way. She wanted to be awake so she could go to him. Well, at the age of 15, Marina has a double stroke, so severe she cannot walk and she cannot hold a water glass. Her first thought is to her son, and she knows off reserve she would be entitled to receive respite services that would allow Jeremy to stay in the home while she recovers from her stroke so she can care for him. But the government of Canada says no. They say, we have three options for you. The First Nation can pick up the cost, which the First Nation does, by the way. They're the only one that implements Jordan's principle, but they have no revenue to do it. They're simply doing it because it's the right thing to do and praying that the money shows up. But that can't go on forever. And Canada says in an email, if they are not able to fund that, then things will deteriorate in the home because Marina is not able to really even care for Jeremy, given her physical disability. So child welfare will have to intervene and we'll pay for that. Or you can put him in an institution and we'll pay for that. Well, this courageous lady who's just gone through a double stroke decides that she doesn't want any of those outcomes for her son. So she files a charter case against the country of Canada for a failure to implement Jordan's principle and treat her son equally under the law. That case will be heard on June 11th and 12th in Halifax. It's a precedent-setting case, and we're hoping that it, for once, forces the federal government to do what it should be doing as a matter of course. And what about child welfare care? Well, as the Grand Chief has said, there are more First Nations children in care today than there was at the height of residential schools, driven there not by abuse, but by poverty, poor housing, and substance misuse. We know exactly what to do in order to turn the tide, and we are not doing it. We're not modifying child welfare to be able to respond to those needs. And the federal government is underfunding child welfare by a desperate amount. This is Canada's own document obtained under access to information. This is about the funding formula used here in British Columbia to apply to First Nations children in your province. They say it creates dire circumstances, that the level of inadequate prevention resources is driving children into foster care, and what they're worried about is these children growing up and suing the government of Canada. The province also knows the situation is existing, and they are standing on the reserve lines allowing it to happen. 53% of all children in foster care in this province are First Nations, and this is a big contributing factor. So what do you do about that? Well, the federal government, if they were here, would call your attention to the fact that they're spending twice as much on child welfare than they have in preceding years, and that is true. But what the detail that they leave out is over 10 years ago, when we were sitting around the table drafting these solutions, we told them that if you do not invest in prevention services and equitable supports, we're going to see growing numbers of children being wrongfully removed from their families and placed in foster care. And that's going to drive your costs up. And that's what you see in this internal document. This is their own PowerPoint slide from 2010. And you can see the red bar there is maintenance. Maintenance is paid when a child comes into care. By far, that's the biggest driver. The government has announced a new thing called enhanced prevention. Now, it's better than the Dyer formula, but the Auditor General has found it to be not dire and inequitable, but flawed and inequitable. So those are the two options available for First Nations kids. And if you looked at what flawed and inequitable provides you, it's that green bar. So it's almost nothing in comparison to try and prevent children from going into foster care and being safely in their family homes. So what did we do? Well, we're a small four-person organization located in Ottawa, and we are working with chiefs and First Nations Child Welfare Agency directors all over the country. What we know is this much for sure. We continue to talk to Canada. We continue to try and demonstrate through research the inequity, the level of the inequity, the solutions and the impacts of the inequity as we've done for well over a decade. If we invest in that again, more and more children will go into child welfare care. In fact, in the 10 years we did do that, the number of First Nations kids going into child welfare care by Canada's own data increased 71.5%. So at some point, you have to say that we have to do something different. So in 2007, we filed a human rights case against Canada alleging that they're racially discriminating against First Nations children. That case is considered to be one of the most important human rights cases of our time, and we're very thankful to Amnesty International has joined us in the intervention of that case. Canada is not fighting it on the merits. They are fighting it on two legal technicalities. They're saying, we as a federal government do not provide child welfare. I provide it to the service provider, and they provide an inequitable level of care, so hold them responsible. And if you're not convinced by that argument, they say it's not fair to us, the federal government. After all, I think as taxpayers, that's what we're always concerned about the most, is if the federal government's treated fairly. It's not fair to us as a federal government to compare us to the provincial governments who are funding the services for all others. Well, that argument was actually successful in the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal. And we can see here that they've tried twice in federal court to derail the tribunal on those two issues. They failed. They then went to the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal, succeeded. But thankfully, that decision has been overturned in federal court. Because should that comparator issue have held, there would have been a vacuum of human rights for all First Nations people. There would have been no way to appeal inequities in water, housing, education, health for First Nations folks on reserve because it's all funded by the feds. And this is just a snapshot of the actual decision by Federal Court Justice McTavish. And you can see there that not only did she feel the comparator issue was wrong, but she also found the process at the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal to be unfair. Why? Because the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal chair says in the order she looked at over 10,000 pages of material. But we have we're blessed, by the way. I just want to give a real big shout out to Steichman Elliott, the law firm, because they're representing us pro bono on this case, and it's the only way we could stand up for First Nations kids as long as we have. And they've got a very talented lawyer there who actually took the time to count up the pages that were properly before Chitalia, the tribunal chair, and there was only 2,000 pages. So somehow another 8,000 pages was considered that nobody knows about. The only indication we have about what was in those 8,000 pages is in the order itself, where the chair of the tribunal says, I looked at a report filed by Canada 2 months after the hearing concluded. Now, the government, on behalf of all of us in this room, is appealing this decision into the Federal Court of Appeal. They're appealing even on that ground of fairness. Somehow, I guess they're going to say, we want members of the judiciary to look at 8,000 pages of material that nobody knows about. I said, I'm not actually against that in some ways. I'm just thinking if we can make sure that that's actual factual material, then I think Canada will lose on the vast majority of its cases. But I suspect it's only material that the AG would find favorable. Let's see if we can get this thing back up. It seems to be knocking out every once in a while. So we are going to have, for the first time in the history of this country, a hearing on the merits, because thanks to the federal court justice, whether the Canadian government is racially discriminating against children. The Auditor General's report would suggest that they are. The Parliamentary Budget Officer's report would suggest that they are. Their own internal documents suggest that they are. Their own expert reports suggest that they are. And as many people say to me, I find it extraordinary that we even have to bring this case at all. And we have something called the I Am a Witness campaign, where we load up all of Canada's documents and all of our documents, and we invite caring Canadians to watch. And there's over 10,000 people filing the case right now, and the vast majority of them are children. And when we had the hearing in federal court in February, there were about two-thirds of the 200 people who came every day were children. And you might wonder what children have to say about this case. What could they possibly get out of this? Well, there was one little boy, and he's 10 years old. He draws a line down the center of his page, and he has tallies, you know, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 across. Long list of them on one side and a shorter list on the other. And he calls me over, and he says, "Do you know what this is?" He said, "Well, the long list is when the judge asked the Canada people a question, and the short list is when they answered." I went out, and I saw a grade 2 class. And they said, "Why are we here? Like, isn't it obvious that they're supposed to be treating all the kids the same? Why would the government be saying that that's not the way it's supposed to be?" That really is the most important question that the Canadian government should be asked. And when we ask Canadians that question, you can see that the government is adrift of the values of Canadians all over the country. 97% say yes. The other 2% are probably the people who make comments about Aboriginal stories on CBC and the websites, and many of us know about those. Now, this isn't the focus of it, but I just want to point out that the government has taken quite an interest in my activities. And I think it's interesting that in a democracy such as Canada, we have the government spending thousands and thousands and thousands of taxpayer dollars that should be going to Marina and her son, following around a woman who doesn't even have a parking ticket, let alone a criminal record. And I should say that I've done a detailed kind of mapping of this, and we're finding that it's 165 government officials across justice and Aboriginal affairs. So these aren't even trained RCMP officers. These are bureaucrats, which I think is even more scary. I sometimes look out of my brownstone in Ottawa and look for people with lanyards, because those are all the public servants, and wonder if that's going to happen or not. So, but I want to say this. The worst thing that we could do is be afraid in the face of this. I have found myself to believe that we are in the right, standing on the rights of First Nations children, and I will not be silenced regardless of whatever the government of Canada puts over. And we must not make ourselves the victims as adults in this scenario. The ones that are the true victims are the children. And we must never be quiet because the Canadian government doesn't like it. And the Privacy Commissioner is now investigating that, so we'll see what she has to say. Now, what about the kids? What are the kids doing? Well, these are the kids on Have a Heart Day. And for First Nations children, we invited First Nations, non-Aboriginal children to join us on Parliament on February 14th outside of the hearings of the Supreme Court of Canada. And they had letters for the Prime Minister. And I'm just going to share a couple of letters here, and you're going to read some of them for yourself in a minute. Well, one little girl, she gets up there and she says, "Dear Prime Minister Harper, I think you should go back to grade 5, because that's where you learn about the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And if you read that thing, you would know what kids in grade 1 in my school already know. And that is, you're supposed to be treating everybody fairly. And you're breaking your laws, and that's not right, because you're supposed to be the one in charge." And then we have Elliot. And he stands up there, and he's got his paper, and it's cold. It's Ottawa, and it's February. And he says, "Dear Prime Minister Harper, I do not know why you're over in China criticizing their human rights when you're violating rights here." So the kids by the thousands are standing up, not against the government, not against the Conservative Party, not against the Liberal Party, not against the Bloc Québécois, and not against the NDP. They are standing up for the value of equality and fairness. When I asked the kids, I said, "The governments are finding it hard to implement Jordan's principle. Do you know how to implement it?" And then one little guy puts his hand up right away and he said, "Rock, paper, scissors." And that makes more sense than anything that they've come up with in the last 7 years since Jordan has passed. So we're having a walk on June 11th in Ottawa, where we're inviting caring Canadians of all sorts to write letters to the Prime Minister to say that every child in this country deserves a chance to grow up safely in their families, be proud of who they are, go to good schools, and be healthy. And what you do is you walk to the mailbox with your letters. So this can be done anywhere in the country, and there's walks here in Vancouver, and I hope that you will join. But we are going to have about 1,000 to vote 1,500 little kids walking on Parliament Hill and blowing bubbles. And they have messages for their country. You know, we all, it's so easy to say that children are our future and that we really care about them the most, but the reality is that our political action would suggest that we don't really believe it. So the kids aren't prepared to give it up to adults and hope that you do the right thing. They're going to take action themselves. And so I don't know what the Prime Minister is going to do in response to his mail, but I do know this. That this generation of First Nations children will be able to look out at their non-Aboriginal children and know that they do not stand by themselves, that they are not forgotten. And this generation of non-Aboriginal children will be able to look back at First Nations kids and know that the gift to them all was an opportunity to stand up for the right thing in peaceful and respectful ways that breathe life into that line, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. I've asked you to do three things that take under 2 minutes that are completely free. Sign on to Jordan's Principle, sign on to Shannon's Dream, and sign on to the I Am a Witness campaign. If you cannot do those things, skip by those lines when you sing the national anthem because you don't know how to do it. And here's the letters from the kids. They can teach you how and give you the inspiration that you need on how to make this a better country for us all. Sound, please. A sentinel, I can see everything you're trying to hide. There's never been a moment when First Nations children needed you to stand tall as citizens in this country as it is right now. And the good news is there's never been a time when you could do more to help. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Cindy, for a remarkable presentation and for your exceptional work. That was wonderful. I'm pleased to say that we have some time for questions. We have 15 minutes, so if anyone has questions, we'll run out in the back of the room.
And I should say that the kids wrote a book, which you saw some of the pages are, and they titled it themselves, and it's called Children's Voices Have Power, Children Standing in Solidarity with First Nations Children. And we ran out of the first batch because the kids said they've been giving away their book, which really is their book. But we just got a second printing, and they just arrived in our office today. So if you want to see it, it's really an inspirational book. And it's going into every elementary school in Ontario.
Thank you for your presentation. Needless to say, it was, of course, excellent. You've spoken very, very eloquently on behalf of First Nations children. Do you take an interest in Métis as well?
We do, of course, of all children. It's not, it, to me, these are not categories, these are artificial categories. I stand on guard for all, the sacredness of all kids, including the non-Aboriginal kids. It doesn't work if you diminish one group to uplift the rights of another. That strategy doesn't work. And so we all lift ourselves up together. But I'm also very mindful and respectful of the right to the Métis people to speak for themselves. And so when they invite me to be of support to their work, then I am pleased to stand with them. But I also am respectful of the fact that they have got their own great advocates, such as Janine Carrier. In fact, Janine and I are going to be collaborating on a chapter for the Truth and Reconciliation Commission on Aboriginal Children. So that watch for that in the coming years.
Thank you very much for sharing your knowledge. I think the world needs you. I wanted to ask you, it's good that you get children involved. Is there any role which parents and grandparents can play as well? Because I believe in multi-generation struggle for global justice. And I will share you, I have written a poetry for your children. If, do you mind, will take 1 minute to read it.
Please.
We are Mother Earth. I am a fruit tree. I am a fruitful tree. I'm a banana tree. I grow bananas shaped like human lips to share and tell stories with my global friends. I'm a cherry tree. I grow cherries shaped like human eyes to share and explore with my global friends. I'm a pear tree. I grow pears shaped like a human nose to share and smell with my global friends. I'm an avocado tree. I grow avocados shaped like human ears to share and listen with my global friends. I am an olive tree. I grow olives shaped like a human hand to share and shake hands with my global friends. I am an orange tree. I grow oranges shaped like a human head to share and learn with my global friends. I am a mango tree. I grow mangoes shaped like human feet to share and play with my global friends. I am an apple tree. I grow apples shaped like a globe to share and learn about colors with my global friends. I am a fruit tree. I am a fruitful tree, shaped like a fruit basket, to share fruit salad with my global friends.
Aww.
Thank you.
Thank you. The all of our campaigns are not targeted at the rich. They're actually targeted for the poor. We're one of the few NGOs. By the way, we have no federal government funding. We were cut 30 days after we did it. But we don't target the rich in terms of inviting them to our galas. All of our campaigns are developed, so they're completely free to do. Because we won't even do food drives, because we know that for some children they have to bring food from the food bank for the food drive. So we ask all Canadians of all ages to write letters to the Prime Minister, to come out on the walks, to write to their members of Parliament, to stand with their children, to learn more about these campaigns. We've got beautiful videos where you can even listen to this gorgeous Chanukhu Stachan doing a speech for 500 non-Aboriginal kids about why you need to stand up for what you believe in. All of those things are free on your website. So I think there's absolutely a role for extended family. And the beautiful thing of what we're finding with the kids is the kids will come by themselves as part of their class for the first one. And then moms and dads are coming with the younger siblings, and then they're bringing the grandparents. So the crowd is getting bigger all the time, which is exactly what we want.
I just want to say thank you for making me mad as hell. I'm from Ontario, and unfortunately, I didn't have the pleasure of learning about all of these things when I was growing up, and I think that's a very big thing that my generation has missed. So my question is to address that ignorance, the pervasive ignorance of my generation, and even, you know, the light racism that comes along with that. How do you, as a very outspoken and strong person, obviously, with a very strong opinion, approach people in your social circles who you find maybe are ignorant of the issues or say things that are, quite frankly, completely unacceptable?
Well, it's an important question, and I need to come back to this. I absolutely believe in the goodness of people. And that's my starting point. And I believe that the only thing I can do for people who have grown up without that information and maybe have stereotypes is give them an opportunity to have the proper information. And whatever they do after that, I have no control over. My goal is not to get rid of the 2% on that graph. My goal is to make them a minority, which thankfully they are already. And so on our websites, we try to make it easy for good people like yourself. There's copies of the reports by the Auditor General. There's copies of the reports by the Parliamentary Budget Officer. We have even Canada's own documents posted up there so that people can go and inform themselves. And I put it this way to people. I said, look, I'm standing up here and I'm alleging that the Canadian government is racially discriminating against children. I put up all my information as to why I think that's true. If you don't think I'm right, then you should at least be able to come up with a few documents to prove I'm wrong. And, you know, I think the question is important enough and to the fundamental notion of the country that you should undertake that investigation. If it only is to go onto Google and try to find one document that supports it. The Government of Canada has undertaken that activity. We know from their witness list for the tribunal, all they could find are their own public servants. They couldn't find one of the 17,000 licensed social workers in this country that's prepared to testify on their behalf. Oh, sorry.
I just want to thank you so much for your words. I want to say that my mother taught me that we are our stories. And I think if we are going to change a society that's miring inequality and injustice, we need to start rechecking the story that we tell ourselves each day of who we are and what does it mean to be part of Canada, to negate the fact that Indigenous people existed, live here, have communities, have languages, culture, art, and that all of those things that we do, all of those things that we learn in our home contribute to who we become as a society. That diversity makes us rich. It doesn't deplete us, that it makes us stronger, that it makes us survive. And so if we're going to advocate for the children more than just schools, more than just having a place to have dreams, we have to talk about the inequality that today pervades our society. And I think that's the most important part of your work, is that it makes that visible. So the job really is for all of us to find those spaces day to day in the actions, in the words we use, in the stories we tell ourselves, in the misinformation that we continuously perpetuate. So thank you very much for your work and for your challenge to all of us.
Thank you. And I think it's important that we really do come out on the side of equality as a fundamental value. I don't stand here and just say equality for First Nations kids. I say equality for all children. And I go beyond that, equality for all people. We can't piecemeal these issues. We can't say that I want mine to be at the top of the list and therefore persons with disabilities and everything else has to fall in behind. We have to lift up together from a place of values. People like Martin Luther King and Mahatma Gandhi have taught us that much. And the area where I think we need to start is discrimination is horrible no matter where it happens. And it happens on the streets. We all see it. But it is absolutely most potent when it's our governments that are doing it. And that's the difference here. This isn't a corporation. This isn't just a group of citizens. This is our government racially discriminating against children.
Hi, Cindy. My name is Randy Gerholt-Seary, and I work with children in the inner city and around Vancouver. I would have to just thank you for your words today, because I've been wanting to hear you speak for an awful long time. Mm-hmm. Whenever I've been in Ottawa, I've actually missed you, so I want to thank you for your words. I also do a lot of work within Vancouver and Canada at trying to promote what we're trying to advocate for, a national child care that provides care for all children. And a lot of the work that we're doing is on the rights of the child, and the work that you do just speaks profoundly about the rights of children in our country and the fact that our country is failing in protecting those rights. And I was very touched by the work that you're doing with children and having children speak out about that. And my question is within our school settings, how did that work get into the schools where you were able to speak to the children about Shannon's dream and Jordan's principle and get their participation in that political action? Because that's not always an easy thing to do within the systems that we have that restrict those kind of political actions. So I'm curious as to how you did that, because that's something I would certainly like to participate in.
Well, I call it citizenship. And what happened is actually not, we always welcome children in all of our Caring Society gatherings and all our talks. And thankfully, children came out. It was children who actually deserved the credit for getting it into the schools. The teachers will tell you that it's not them who are saying that we need to do something on Shannon's dream. Literally, delegations of children would be, I get emails so often where, you know, a principal will say, 4 10-year-olds came to say that we're doing something on Shannon's dream in our school. And they said that I had to call you to talk to you about that. And in fact, the children from Have a Heart Day, just to give you an example, what they did by, like, I have no control over this movement anymore, which I think is fantastic. So the children actually created delegations of children who felt it was important that they go to other elementary schools who may not have heard this message. And they were going to tell them about it and ask them to come to Have a Heart Day. And that's why our numbers went from 600 to well over probably 1,500 or so. And the kids are in charge of the rallies. So it's not you come and you get to listen to me. The kids decide the whole agenda. All I do is host these days, and the kids take it over. And I think that that's important, because I think in human rights, we really infantilize children. Or we talk about youth as being engaged in human rights, but I think we need to start much earlier. My constituency has a nap time, but they often will do much more than, you know, the other ones that are napping in Houses of Parliament and Senate. So we have to just re-gauge that. Huh?
I'm with the Justice Unit of the Anglican Church, and I am very embarrassed to say that, because the church has so much to answer for. Particularly with regard to the residential schools, because that debt can never be paid. It must be forever talked about. But I was wondering if you could comment, please, on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission that has had these meetings throughout Canada. I've been to several of them, and I would like to know who funds them, what they hope to accomplish, and what do you think of them?
Well, it is done by a joint agreement. The Grand Chief might know more about this than I do, about the actual structure of it. The whole idea is to bring the story to Canadian consciousness and to create learning so that we restructure Canadian society and the relationships between First Nations and non-Aboriginal people and Métis and Inuit in a way that these types of human rights abuses don't happen again. From my own part, I have a very simple definition of reconciliation, and that is not saying sorry twice. That's why I'm so engaged on kind of saying what we can do right in this generation. And I should say with regard to the churches, my view of it is, yes, there are things that need to be learned at. The way to express that learning is to help us with this generation of children. And we've been so thankful for the many invitations we get to talk to church congregations who are signing up for Shannon's dream and Jordan's principle and coming out to the courts, as well as the support of Cairo. So there's something all of us can do to set this right. We can't make it up for the past, but we can pay those lessons forward for this generation and the ones to follow. And I think that's the hope of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission through these hearings. And as I talk to survivors of residential schools, the number one thing that I hear across it is I don't want my grandkids to go through this. That's the debt that I think that all of us absolutely owe to every person who went through residential schools. Let's not have it happen again.
Thank you very much for all of your questions. Thank you, Cindy, thank again. You. You're clearly an exceptional advocate, and not just because you've never had a parking ticket, which is pretty great. Please join me in thanking Cindy one more time for joining us.